And so the church is meant to be a place where we can grow. Grow closer to God. And not only get to a place where we so value Him, but value each other. I think sometimes we lose sight of that. I think there's a danger in our generation where we become real selfish and all we care about is me. That's not what the body of Christ is supposed to be. Today we're celebrating you.
Hi, my name's Angel Falcon and I'm honored to be before you here today. We believe that there's no greater responsibility entrusted to us as believers to give you, teach you the Word of God. I trust that you will be richly blessed by what you're about to hear. Remember that as we increase in the knowledge of God's Word, His blessings are sure to fall upon us. Trust you will be blessed.
The only way that they can be significant is if they stand behind this pulpit. Long before I stood behind this pulpit, I was in the pulpit in my house. My house was my pulpit. My family was my pulpit. My job, whoo, that was my pulpit. You know? But you are, my point is that you, what you do here every day is significant. And I don't think sometimes you realize how important you really are. See, most of you don't really know all of the intricate details that takes place each and every day in the lives of a lot of people, but maybe because, and some of you do, but it's beautiful to see what God intended to do in His people. God, in His wisdom, knows that we need each other. And you understand this, God instituted family because we need family. God instituted the church because we need a family. And also because sometimes you're in a family that needs some help.
Amen.
What you talking about, Pastor? Some family need help. We're, turn to someone and says, I am, I confess, I am a work in progress. And so God, in His wisdom, brings us together. And it's beautiful because God, in His Word, He sheds some light that, you know, that you can help me, I can help you, and we can all help each other. We're not all there, but we can help each other. And here's the kicker. The battles I had to fight and win, I can teach you to fight and win. There's battles with my health, battles with a failed marriage. Hello? Battles, all kinds of stuff, challenges that come your way. But God called us together so that we can come in God's house, pursuing His presence and allowing Him to reveal His wisdom to us for life. God instituted marriage. Don't you think that He knows how to counsel you in order to help you with your challenges? I think He does. And so the church is meant to be a place where we can grow. Grow closer to God. And not only get to a place where we so value Him, but value each other. I think sometimes we lose sight of that. I think there's a danger in our generation where we become real selfish and all we care about is me. That's not what the body of Christ is supposed to be. Today we're celebrating you. I'm celebrating you. How many of you? Confession time. How many of you? God woke you up in the strangest times. Maybe while you're even walking, buying at a food, you know, at the supermarket or walking the mall. How many of you, God put somebody in your heart to pray for? How many? Good, put your hands down. How many, God said, pray for pastor? You don't know how many hundreds of people through the years have come to me and gave me a word of encouragement right when I need it. Because sometimes, see, all you see is my face and you see, whoa, pastor got it all together. Well, sometimes it's a fight. Sometimes, you know, there's T.D. Jakes shared a series that I was so blessed with. He said, leading while bleeding. Sometimes I got to force myself up here because, not because I don't want to, but because I have to, even though I'm all beat up. Amen. But I know God's got me, right? Yes. So this is who we are. I love the fact that we have people here who, you know, not only are in love with God, but when you're in love with God, you love people. Yes. Say that with me. If I love God,
I love his people.
Let me say it this way so that you, if you say you love me, you better love my wife. Because then we are not, this is not going to flow. We got to love each other. Doesn't mean that we have to accept everything. Sometimes we got issues, we got hang-ups. You know, we have faults. Some of us are real. Some of us, our nickname should be sandpaper. You ever come across some sandpaper people? Rough. But you know what? This is just a process. You don't think, even among Jesus' 12 disciples, they had issues. Peter had a head on him. He was, you know, loved God, but he always put his foot in his mouth. Jesus had to deal with a lot of in his 12, he had to deal with them because they say, well, when Jesus goes, who's going to be the greatest and who's going to lead this crowd? You know, so Jesus had to deal with. He had to deal with someone who betrayed him. Probably the most difficult thing for anybody to go through. But still, God has called us. It has always been. I want you to know that it has always been the central truth of this house to love God and love one another. Amen. Jesus himself says, you will know them. You will know that they're my disciples for real by their love for one another. Amen. But in the process of this love, God works. God brings correction. Listen, even in this environment, in the church environment, there are times when you're going to hear something you're not going to like. And I like to keep everybody happy. But I've been around way too long to know that that's not always I'd like everybody to be happy, but not everybody's going to be happy if I have to tell them what they need to hear.
Amen.
But this is what we're celebrating. Right now, I just remember the thousands of people that have come through this thing, and our commitment was for them to grow in the knowledge of who God is and who He is in them. That has always been our commitment. Has everything been perfect? Oh, no. I want to really fit in another word in there. Oh, no. No. We have had challenges. We have, you know, I've always shared at the board level with our leadership, you know, it was our strength that got us there. Our strength and weaknesses. Right? It's all of it working together, trying, you know, to pursue the heart of God and the will of God. And that's what we have been all about. We have been about supporting. We have had countless people come here so broken. I've had ministers and pastors come through here with their families broken. And by the grace of God, I've seen restoration. I've seen alcoholics be delivered. And now that alcoholic is able to help others, amen, with their struggle. It's almost like our mess became our message, right?
Amen.
And so we're celebrating because we, you know, to me, it's not, you know, when you are all out for loving God, it just has a ripple effect on everything in your life. You not only begin to care more about others and even deny yourself so that you can help somebody else. And that's taking place all the time. And you don't know the joy that I see when I see people walking and I see them sacrificing, and when I see them getting up in the middle of night, going to someone's house because they call them. When they're supporting each other, when they're helping each other with food, when they're helping each other to meet the rent, the car note, car insurance. It's precious. So I realized that the church is kind of a support group in a very real way. And so that's why I'm celebrating you. And hopefully, maybe even those of you that are kind of still sitting in the back, you know, not in the back necessarily, but just sitting back. The three back rows, I still have a head snap. But hopefully, you know, I just want you to know that you're a part of something, of a family. And that doesn't mean that we're perfect. But we're pursuing an amazing God who seeks to perfect us through the process. And I'm thankful every day for that. And there are challenges in between and there's stuff, you know, but God has a way of always bringing to my remembrance. And somehow He'll talk to somebody to come to me to remind me. And sometimes those families no longer here. They're no longer here. They have been away for years. But I get that call saying, Pastor, man, I thank you for that season that I was in God's house. And I learned some principles that I'm applying still today. And because of it, my family is stronger than ever. I love that. That's what you're a part of. My passion, I came to the Lord when I grew up knowing God, understand that. I grew up knowing God. But through my lifetime, I've had some seasons where I had what I call pivotal moments where God really revealed Himself profoundly to me. I remember at the age of 10, when God showed up and started speaking to me about some things that I was witnessing. And then at the age of 20, when I realized what God was revealing to me at 10 years old, that made more sense when I was 20. And it was that moment when I just totally committed myself, because I knew that pursuing God was far more beneficial for me than anything else. So as a pastor, I had grown. I was hungry for God. I began to, and this is what this house represents. It represents a moral compass. When we instill the Word of God in you, it just instructs, it strengthens the person you are. Your character is strengthened. And that character will bring you success. I don't care where you go. And it will always raise the standard of your life. When you base your life on God's word and you don't compromise it, you don't know the doors that God will open for you. Stuff happens. I love that scripture that says that a righteous man may fall, but he'll get back up again. See, you don't quit just when things just get hard. You keep pressing on, amen, finding the heart of God. And I realize how challenging that could be at times, because we're an emotional people. And sometimes we allow our emotions to get the best of us. But you know what? This is where God comes in. And this is what I want to celebrate today. It's about God. It's about His will. It's about loving each other unconditionally. I don't love you because you did nice things for me. I don't love you just because you sent me that awesome card with my favorite restaurant gift card. I appreciate that, but I don't love you because of that. I love you because of who you are. And I love the fact that you come here week after week to pursue God, to do right, to honor Him. My deepest, and it's part of our mission statement, is to pursue His purpose. And I know that if I align myself up with God's purpose, that His blessings follow. And I've realized that if I teach God's children that, I surrendered my life completely. I loved God. I was going to church. I was part of a church in my early years. I went to parochial school till I was 14. From first grade till I was 14, junior high. But I had knowledge of God. I had a fear of God. But I really encountered God when I turned 20. And it's then when I realized that I had a passion for God, and I was so hungry for God. I signed up for Bible Institute, and immediately, you know, God started pulling on my heart, and I've been a part of, listen carefully, I've been a part of churches that were structurally amazing. I mean, breathtaking cathedrals, right? But then God took me to a little humble little place where, for the very first time, I felt the presence of God. And that kind of messed me all up. Because oftentimes we label the presence of God with grandeur and not presence. So it has been our desire here at Faith Alive to create. Again, I'm not saying I have not made my mistakes. I wish I can. You know, I've Oftentimes I told the Lord, when he called me, I'm a confess to you, God knows that. When God says, I want you to start a church, I say, say what? I says, did you notice how many churches are on Suffolk Avenue? From Central Islip to Brentwood? Do you know how many churches are in there? Do you really need another church? I was honest. But I realized he began to show me some things, amen, and revealing to me as to what he wanted to do, and it really grabbed hold of me profoundly. Because a lot of times churches, listen, you know what's sad? And don't wanna be very careful how I say this, because I've been in churches that helped me immensely, but then I almost like I outgrew it. Church has to be a place where you continue to grow. And so it has always been my desire to create a type of environment where that's possible, where gifts can be displayed, where we can grow and love each other. You know, because you're going to be tested here. You test me. I love you, but sometimes we can test each other, right? How many times have I said something and you said, I don't know. Right? So we test each other. But God has called us to be able to be strong enough, resolve enough, temperate enough, you know, to help the process. The process. Be a part of the process. And God, I remember that scripture verse. I'll never forget that scripture verse that says that you know, God has called us to be joined together, with each part supplying theirs. So this is the heart of God. The heart of God is that we strengthen each other, that we learn from each other. You're not going to grow if you don't allow yourself to be teachable here. And so that's why today, we wanted to do it in Hector State Park, but that didn't work out. And sometimes it saddens me when I rally up the church family to come out and some of them don't see the importance enough. And so the reason why we're not having it on another Saturday is because all our Saturdays for September was booked. And so I know that this is valuable for us when we come together, when we pray for our brothers and sisters. You don't know how important it is to be sensitive enough to know when people need encouragement. I want to celebrate your efforts. You know, God says, everything you do will not go unrewarded. Turn to someone and say, did you hear that? Now, we're not doing what we do to get rewarded, but God says, everything you do. So God is sitting in his throne. He says, I see what you're doing. I'm going to bless that. Because you were thinking of others before yourself, I'm going to take care of you. So nothing you do goes unrewarded by God. Oftentimes I'm tempted to tell, you know, to testify of some things that went on, but then I remember that whatever you do privately, God will reward you openly. So I'm tempted, even right now, I'm tempted to say, you know, some things that people did that went above and beyond what they should have done, but they did it anyway. And rescued families, intervene in such a way that it was a blessing. I know I haven't even read a scripture verse. But I'm going to hand this over in about 5 minutes. But I want to let you know this, that we're committed to loving you till Jesus comes. I realize that a healthy church requires God's uncompromising word. That word has to be challenging to the people. I'm not going to candy coat to you, beloved. I can't candy coat, because I know that I got to stand before God and give an account for you. My job is to give it to you just the way the word says it, in love, in the spirit of love, and then it's up to you. I hope that when I get before God, I told him not to do that. Se lo dije. But I believe with all my heart that God is building us, strengthening us by what each of us supply.
How many are blessed tonight? ¿Cuántos son bendecidos esta mañana? Dios es bueno. God is good. It's hard to stand up after someone else preaches it, you know. Es bien duro pararse después que alguien predica. Pero este día yo sé que Dios tiene una palabra para ti. I know the Lord has a word for you this morning, and I'm grateful for everything. I'm thankful for this week because it's been special for me. And I want to thank everyone that has sent me a shout out. Gracias por aquellos que me han mandado un mensaje. Me toca mucho mi corazón y puede que comience a llorar. No voy a hablar de eso ahora. If I speak about all the messages, I'll be crying a little bit, so I'm not going to do that today. God has been good to us. You know, the Lord has given a word. El Señor ha dado una palabra a esta casa en estas semanas, y hoy nos sentimos contentos que estás aquí. We're really grateful that you're here today, because it's good that we're together. Bueno que estemos juntos. Hay iglesias que se reúnen más frecuente, pero nosotros este día estamos aquí contigo. Por eso estamos comenzando algo nuevo. Dígame. We're starting something new today. And we're glad to be here. La semana pasada íbamos a tener un picnic. El pastor Falcón habló un poquito acerca de eso. Y yo quiero que los que no entendieron español sepan un poco que nuestro plan era que todo el mundo esté. Our plans last week was that everybody be there. Y hoy tú llegaste. Y es importante. Y quiero seguir con el mensaje del pastor Falcón, porque yo sé que es importante la unidad en la casa. ¿Cuántos dicen amén? Can we go to the book of Acts? I'm going to translate as best I can a little bit, okay? So bear with me. Thank God we Spanish it here in New York. Qué bueno que estamos en Nueva York y hablamos un poquito de español e inglés. ¿Tú sabes cómo es, verdad? Diga amén. En Puerto Rico se llama sancocho. In Puerto Rico we call it stew. We know a little bit of everything. Soon we'll learn your language. You're saying, Pastor, why is Spanish English? We know we're going to learn your language. Don't worry. I had a vision today. Tuve una visión hoy cuando estábamos cantando. I had a vision where we were talking. I said, how is heaven? ¿Cómo será el cielo? Porque hoy estábamos cantando inglés y español. Today we'll sing in Spanish and English. And I'm saying, wow, how great heaven's going to be. Y yo fui bendecido. And I want to share that with you right now. Yo fui bendecido. I was blessed because I speak both languages. But when we get to heaven, I'm going to know your language. You're going to know my language. Imagine all the languages that are out there in the world. Va a ser tremendo. Ese coro, I had the pleasure. Tuve el placer de ir a un lugar donde todo el mundo cantó. You know, you ever been somewhere everybody sings? Because sometimes in church, not everybody sings. I'm sorry, brother. I'm not talking about you. No estoy hablando de ti. Puede que tú no cantes. Pero yo fui a un lugar que todo el mundo cantó. Everybody. Todo el mundo. They were excited. Hands are moving. And then the worship leader lo tenía bien fácil. El que estaba dirigiendo tuvo bien fácil, porque lo que él hacía, todo el mundo hacía. Whatever he did, everybody did, because we were one accord. It's amazing. Then he asked us all, nos dijo a todos nosotros, por favor, cojan su mano derecha y hagan esto a la misma vez. Uno, dos y tres. And at the same time, we all did it. One, two, three. And we were worshiping, and every time I said, let's do it. And I just looked around, it was heavenly. It was so God is good. I don't know why we're there, but God knows why. You're not left out, you're included. Por eso estamos aquí hoy. Vamos a Hechos capítulo 2. Capítulo 42. Let's go to Acts chapter 2. It's not even in notes. The Lord just gave it to me when I got here. 42. It says this. Dice la palabra de Dios de esta forma. Dice, y perseveraban en la doctrina de los apóstoles. Lo importante es perseverar. Diga, perseveran. Lo importante, diga lo mismo. Lo importante es perseverar. In English, it says like this. And they continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine. Can we say this? And they continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine. Significa que ellos no solamente la escucharon, pero se quedaron con la palabra. They did not just hear the word, they stood on the word. I believe we have a lot of people like that here today. Yo sé que hay muchos así aquí hoy. And it says this. En comunión uno con otros, and in communion in the breaking of bread and prayer. Lo bueno que hoy vamos a romper pan. Today we're going to break bread together. We're going to eat. I hope you have enough to share. Aleluya. Yo espero que compartas un poquito, ¿la? De lo tuyo. Qué bueno compartir, ¿la? Y usted sabe que cada vez que compartimos, nos unimos. En nuestro servicio de español parece que toda la semana estamos compartiendo algo. Todos los jueves. Every service, it seems like we're breaking bread. There's always something. Thursday, I didn't know that they were celebrating my birthday. I went over there. I said, what is this cake doing here? Yo no sé, ¿qué hace este bizcocho aquí? Y me dijeron, pastor, no se preocupe, hay fiesta. Don't worry about fast. There's a party going on. And God is good because that keeps us together. El rompimiento de pan nos hace juntos. When we break bread, we become family. I feel led by the Spirit of God. I'm going to disorder the whole church right now. Yo quiero que todos se pongan en pie. Can we all stand up for a minute? I may not preach long. Yo no voy a predicar largo. Pero alguien aquí necesita que alguien lo abrace. Someone needs a hug. I'm feeling led by the Spirit. Can you just feel led by the Spirit? Can you just break? Tú te puedes salir de tu silla y abrazar a alguien. Can you just go hug somebody? Someone you don't know. Someone you don't know. Someone you don't know. Abraza a alguien que tú no conozcas. Especialmente que no lo conozca. Aleluya, qué desorden. Aleluya. Hay una desorden en la casa. Aleluya. We need that. Necesitamos esto. Necesitamos esto. Esto es lo que se llama comunión. This is what the Bible calls about communion. It's not just being in a place and not knowing somebody. No es como quedarte en un lugar y no conocer a nadie. Hay que conocer a alguien. Qué bueno, qué bueno. I like the disorder. Qué bueno que la desorden está Dios. Someone needs this, so you know, alguien necesita esto. Por eso cuando abrace a esta persona, no lo tome por poco. Alguien necesita un abrazo en este día. Someone needs a hug today. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, sister. God is good. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Gloria a Dios. God is good. Se pueden sentar. You may be seated. Like I shared, I prepared to bring a word. Yo vine a traer una palabra porque pastor, Dios le dio una palabra de intervención divina al pastor Falcón. Y yo me pongo en orden con el mensaje de la casa. Y el Señor me habló un poquito de intervención divina. Y yo sé que el pastor dice, ¿por qué vas a hablar de eso? Porque siento de parte de Dios hablarlo, porque Dios ha hablado esta casa. Gracias por nuestro pastor, ¿verdad? Quiero hablar unos puntitos que el enemigo está atacando a las familias. You know, the enemy is attacking us. And win a fight. But I just want to tell you something. Yo quiero decirte algo. Dios es grande. Our God is greater. Dios es grande. Our God is greater. Es imposible estar triste en la presencia de Dios. It's impossible to be sad in the presence of God. It is impossible to make good decisions with bad information. Es imposible hacer buenas decisiones con mala información. Y el Señor nos habla a nosotros. The Lord has been speaking to this house. And I'm glad you're here today. Yo estoy gozoso que estás aquí hoy. En el libro de Isaías, en Isaiah 59, verse 19, yo no puedo leer completo, pero solamente te voy a leer la parte que dice, parte B, dice, porque vendrá el enemigo como ríos. Oh, yes. Tú sabes que los ríos son fuertes. No, hay desorden. Cuando viene un río, viene desorden. Mas el Espíritu de Jehová levantará bandera contra él. The enemy will come like a flood. You know, floods don't, they don't take prisoners. I don't know if that makes sense, but I was thinking about it. Does that really make sense? But we say it a lot. The Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. No importa lo que está diciendo este mundo. I don't really care what this world is saying. Hallelujah. My God is greater. Mi Dios es más grande. No importa lo que está haciendo. Vamos para el libro de Timoteo. 2 Timothy. That's when it passes. I don't have no scripture. Don't worry, Pastor. I got a couple. 2 Timoteo 2:9. Dice la palabra de Dios así. Pero this is the New Testament. And Paul is in a situation. Pablo está en una situación. Y él comienza a anunciar algo. Y es importante que lo agarremos. Paul says something that's really important for us to grab hold of. He said, por anunciar estas buenas noticias, sufro mucho. Y estoy en la cárcel. Me tiene encarcelado. Como si fuera un criminal. Qué cosa fuerte, ¿verdad? Eso es lo que Pablo estaba pasando. Dice, después dice esta palabra clave. Y quiero compartir esta palabra profética para ti. Pero el mensaje de Dios no está encarcelado. For which I suffered and trouble and evildoers, even to the point of chains. But the word of God is not changed. That's a prophetic word. The word of God is never changed. A mí no importa lo que diga el mundo. Yo creo en la palabra de Dios. I don't care what the world says. This world says that we are more than overcomers. Esta palabra dice que somos más que vencedores. El mundo puede que diga lo que digas. The world tells us to be sad. El mundo nos dice que tiene que estar triste. I am not going to be sad. Antes no me gustaba el cumpleaños porque uno se pone viejo. I didn't like birthdays. But I love them now. I came to the realization, you know what? Regalos. Pasteles. Aleluya. Fiesta. ¿Qué vamos a hacer si no celebrar? Y he aprendido esto. I learned to celebrate. Hay que celebrar. We're supposed to be joyful. Siempre. Always. He is my source. Él es mi fortaleza. Yo no voy a dejar que este mundo dicte cómo yo me siento. Doy gracias a Dios que si quiero puedo correr. Aleluya. They say when you're 58 you can't run. I could run. Let's run. Aleluya. God is good. I'm not going to pay attention. They tell you, you start forgetting things. That's why I got an iPad. Por eso yo me compré un iPad. Mira, en estos días, mira la tecnología, úsala. Don't conform to this world. No conformes a este mundo. La palabra de Dios no está en cadenas. The word of God is not in chains. And you know, I am tired of religious beliefs. Estoy cansado de los pensamientos religiosos que agarran a la gente y nos tienen en una cueva. They keep us tied up. Jesus said, we are free. Jesús dijo, estamos libres. Y donde está el Espíritu de Dios, hay libertad. Where the Spirit of God is, there's liberty. Oh, Gloria. I want to talk 3 points. Bien rápido, 3 puntitos. Ataca mediante tu finanza. You know where he grabs you and ties you up? In your finances. He grabs your finances. I don't know why it grabs us so. He grips us in that area. Y hay gente que están tan controlados porque le agarraron el dinero. El Dios de nosotros es el Dios de la plata y el oro. Our God is the God of gold and silver. He owns it all. Él tiene dueño de todo eso. Él tiene tu próximo trabajo. He's got your next job. He's got the next door. Él tiene la próxima puerta. Hay gente que están con la puertita. Esa barrita, yo digo mucho en español, que la vaquita, están con la vaquita. Esa vaquita se va a morir. We're holding on to that little cow. That little cow is going to die someday. God's got another fat cow for you. Dios tiene una vaca más gorda para ti. Ese trabajo, hay gente que adora su trabajo. Ay, si pudieras, hicieras un altar para tu trabajo. Y mañana puede que te voten. ¿Y qué vas a hacer? Por eso es que el Dios de nosotros no quiere que tengas presiones financieras. The Lord that we serve is a God that wants us free of debt. Escasez se va. Pastor's right. It's hard to preach because I want to hold back a little bit. Pero te quiero decir algo acerca de la escasez. La escasez es una forma de pensar. When you're thinking lack is a thought. Los israelitas por muchos años en el libro de Josué, de los jueces, verso 7, habla de Gedeón. How many know about Gideon? Por 7 años, dice la palabra de Dios, que los medianitas estaban tomando a ellos sus cosechas. Estaban muriéndose Israel de hambre. For 7 years, the Israelis were starving. And Midianites is a spirit. I feel you've been tied up for 7 years. I'm speaking prophetic to someone here. God is about to make a breakthrough today. Don't think of money. No pienses en dinero. Piensa en ideas. Think of ideas. Porque esa es la área donde Dios te va a enseñar que tú puedes prosperar. Algunos de nosotros estamos estancados esperando a alguien que nos saque. Dios te va a sacar a ti con la idea que te pone en tu corazón. Aleluya. God's going to put something on you to liberate you today in the name of Jesus. I don't lack. Yo no tengo escasez de mi vida. Can we declare that over our lives? I don't lack nothing. Don't look at your finances and say that's the last result. God is about to do something. You want to see it? ¿Tú quieres escuchar algo? Cada vez que una iglesia está en avivamiento, hay un proyecto. Every time the church is about to go into, avivamiento, it's a revival, there's a project. Y algunas veces no hay dinero para eso. Pero yo siempre que he visto que la iglesia se levanta, lo podemos hacer. Every time we raise up and do it, God will do it. I know that we're doing the parking lot. Yo sé que estamos haciendo estacionamiento. Tú lo vas a ver. El año que viene va a estar terminado. ¿Cuánto están conmigo? Yo lo veo terminado. Yo veo la brea. Yo lo veo terminado. Por eso yo te digo a ti que la escasez que tú estás pasando es que Dios va a hacer algo en tus finanzas. Aleluya. That's because God's going to do a breakthrough in your finances. He uses people like you and me. He uses ordinary people. Él usa personas ordinarias y hace grandes cosas. God always does it with los chiquitos. Dios lo hace con los chiquitos. Sanglish. Dios lo hace con los chiquitos. Pero tienes que tener fe. El jueves vamos a el miércoles. Ven aquí el miércoles. Si habla inglés. If you come Wednesday, we're going to talk about that. Ataca también. El ataque viene a producir tristeza, depresión, desánimo, frustración, desengaño. Hasta a veces que, mira, no puedes. You know, he attacks us in areas where depression will come, sadness comes, discouragement comes, frustration. Pero damos gracias a la palabra de Dios. I am grateful for the word of God. Can you go with me to the book of Psalms 34:19? Muchas son las aflicciones del justo. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Del justo. Tú sabes, una persona justa es una persona que vive para Dios. I like the just because that means you're living by the word. If you're living by the word of God, you're a just man of God, a woman of God. God is about to do something. You haven't seen the manifestation because God's about to do it. You're close. Dice, muchas son las aflicciones del justo, pero de todas ellas librará Jehová. And it says, but the Lord will deliver him from from some of them, all of them. Every time I'm hurt, God's about to do something. Siempre que viene algo contra ti, hace uno, le dije, dos, hace, agosto fue un tremendo mes. El enemigo nos atacó a nosotros. Nos quitó todos los carros. In August, we lost all our cars. We're driving to the airport to go on vacation. My car's in the shop. Mi carro estaba en el taller de arreglarlo. Y estamos en el tour de mi esposa y esta mujer nos da a todos los que dan. This lady just rams into my wife's car, my only car at the time. So we went on vacation. So nosotros nos fuimos de vacaciones. José me recogió. Thank you for Brother José. He came and rescued me. Amen. I'm blessed. Listen, the best thing to be in life is to be part of a church. Lo más importante de la vida es ser parte de una iglesia. Porque cuando tú sufres, otros sufren. Because when you're going through something, other brothers will go through it with you. You're not alone. Like I said, hoy vamos a estar afuera, pero lo que tú tienes es para nosotros. Y lo que yo tengo es para ti. What you have is for me, and what I have is for you. Because we're together. El enemigo nos quitó los carros. Y estábamos tristes por unos momentitos. We were sad for a couple of moments. Got in a plane. Took my vacation, came back. Y en medio de todo eso, ganamos. Diga, ganamos. Ganamos porque no tenía finanzas para comprar algo. Y de lo que nos pasó, pude comprar otro y arreglar el mío y arreglar mi esposa y también comprarle un carro a mi hija. Aleluya. Dios sabe todo. Vienen los ataques. Producen tristeza, producen depresión, desánimo, frustración, desgaño. Pero doy gracias a Dios que Dios da ánimo. Y por eso yo me quedo contento. El último punto. This is my last point. Man, time goes fast. Él ataca. Un puertorriqueño escribió esto. Brutalmente las relaciones matrimoniales. He attacks marriages brutally. He attacks our marriages like you don't know. Él ataca tu matrimonio. Mira, el enemigo viene como río. Pero nosotros vamos a levantar la bandera de Dios. He will come like floods to attack your marriage. And he always throws a thought. Viene con un pensamiento. Y de repente la otra persona lo escuchó mal. O no se entiende y comienza a afectarte como tú te relacionas. Ya estás enojado con la persona que tú le dijiste, te amo hasta que la vida. You get annoyed with that person that you said for life. And all of a sudden, if she says or he says, it bothers me. The devil's a liar. He wants to affect your ears. Your marriage is being affected by your ears and the words that come out of your mouth. You bring life into your marriage. Tú traes vida a tu matrimonio. Y el enemigo viene a atacar tu matrimonio. Y hay dolor. It's hard to cut it. Pero voy a cortar con esto. But let's, with this I'm going to end. Go to the marriage conference. Okay? Ve al retiro de matrimonios. No importa el tamaño de angustia, dolor, sufrimiento que estemos enfrentando. Y alguna vez vas a sentir que no hay favor de Dios sobre tu vida, pero la palabra dice esto, que el mensaje del Señor te ha llamado a ti de las tinieblas a su luz admirable. Y la derrota que tú piensas que tienes, tú vas a ver que será victoria en Cristo. Every time that we're facing a matter where we're suffering with anguish or pain or suffering, remember the standard of the Lord. He brought you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And it's powerful enough to defeat any structure that seems unbeatable, but we got to proclaim the word of God. And I'm just going to end with the scripture that we started this teaching. Y perseveraban en la doctrina de los apóstoles. En la comunión el uno con otros, y en el partimiento de pan, y en oración. And they continue steadfast in the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking bread and prayer. I just want to share, it's important that you're here today. Es importante que estés aquí hoy. The enemy is attacking us in three areas that I just spoke about briefly. El enemigo está atacando estas tres áreas. Lo que es relaciones, lo que es finanzas, y lo que es las depresiones y la angustia. Usted y yo tenemos que parar la palabra de Dios contra todo eso, porque el enemigo, esas son las áreas que quitan donde está el gozo de Dios. Can we just stand for a minute? Vamos a ponernos de pie un momentito.